Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Traitor, written by Stephen Daisley and read by Paul English. Dedicated to the memory of C.A. Daisley, nay Lal Radcliffe, 1920-2009. I hate the idea of causes. And if I had to choose between betraying my country and betraying my friend, I hope I should have the guts to betray my country. E.M. Forster. Lemnos, 1915. He moved his leg, and the cloud that covered him moved. And then he thought, perhaps it wasn't him, but the cloud that was moving his leg. Then he knew he was on a hospital barge, crossing a white sea, a thousand bandages unravelling in its wake. Seagulls and the shadows of seagulls followed the barge. With wings as sharp as razors, they crossed above him, calling, "Come away with us. Children, come away with us." He was being touched by hands from out of the darkness, rolled over by many hands, cold scissors along the inside of his right leg. Someone asking, "Is that you, Julia?" And for the rest of his life, he would never know what this meant. The light in the surrounding darkness smelled of kerosene and Condi's crystals. A nurse was holding his wrist. He could feel his pulse against her fingers. He looked at her face as she studied the watch in her other hand. She glanced at him, smiled, looked back to the watch. A few moments passed in silence. She put his wrist down, patted the back of his hand, picked up a clipboard and said, as she wrote, "Hello there, Sergeant David Munro." She was purple and gold and ivory coloured in the light. He couldn't speak. She leaned forward and smiled. "You are a very lucky young man. A few scars is all you will have now. Make the girls love you even more." She looked at him with grey eyes, winked, and turned away. He wanted to say, "You are Irish, and can you sing to me?" Then the wind moved the white canvas of the tent walls. They buckled like wet bedsheets on a washing line. The suspended hurricane lamps swayed. Shadows swayed. Coughing and the creaking of cots. A groan, and someone called out in their sleep, "Muster the Darling Ridge down to the bottom melodies." A hushing sound. David closed his eyes. Clinking noises of metal instruments in enamel bowls, a hissing of lamps. Somebody was answering a question he didn't remember asking.
"He is badly wounded, but will be all right."
Papua Nui Station, New Zealand, 1965. "Mr. Munro?" Catherine reached out and held his arm, tugged at the cloth of his jacket. "Mr. Munro." She shook his arm. The old man had closed his eyes and his head was tilted back. He opened his eyes and looked at her. His head was still back. He was looking at her from a great height. "Are you all right?" But it was already too late.
"Yes,"
he began to say, when he felt the spiral screwing sensation come from his ring finger up and into the biceps of his left arm. He could feel the wet swishing of his urgent heart.
"A daily heartbreak,"
he whispered. He smiled as he whispered to himself, began to fall to his knees. He felt them, the waves, hissing into his left arm and shoulder. Like the love thoughts of a young man, a daily betrayal of who we are. Almost laughed. The words of Mahmoud. Always the words of Mahmoud. He saw both knees fall into the earth. When we are in love, we think our hearts will burst, that we can fly, our heads on fire. He tried to say, I loved your mother, Catherine, more than I can say to you. But as he spoke, he was gripped by a pain that doubled him over and made him cry out with no sense except his pain. He heard her calling to him as he fell forward. The earth was black and green, and it rushed up towards him. There, in the middle, far off, a circle of the brightest light. So it was that he began to die. Often the beckoning and wailing sound of 10,000 voices, the sound of bees, everything he has known coming towards him as he rushes through the darkness at unimagined speeds. And nothing will be as it was. And that which was will echo in us like the whispering of that companion who was always with us and will always be with us. Exquisite delight. Our hands touching once again, as if for the first time. For there are talismans that only we will recognize. These are the strange and wonderful words that came to him as he fell into the earth with the weight in his chest, like that young horse falling on him in the summer of 1947. And he thought, why should I, the he of this dying and remembering, recall that young horse called the Layla, which is Night of Obscurity, a small white mare with hairy ears and a fondness for Bartlett pears, coming back on him with such clumsiness, cleaving his pelvic bones, that if it wasn't for her sweet eyes and evocative name, he would have sold her to Clementine Fabish, the man who wore a black raincoat even in summer. Mahmoud is sitting on a white block of stone in the shadow of the wall. Behind him, in bright sun, there is an arch covered with a grapevine, the leaves turning orange and red in the autumn. The colours in such contrast to the white arch, whose keystone mortar is crumbling. One of the stone segments has slipped, giving the arch a slightly skewed look. Small lizards sunbake and dart across the stone. Rosemary bushes and wild thyme grow among the flagstones, which form a curving path into the ruin. Jerusalem rock roses, tiny and blood red, flank another low wall. He is smiling in welcome. Assalamu alaikum, brother. Peace be upon you. You are coming home. He who dies before he dies will never die. Welcome. David is raising his hand, but is unable to speak. New Zealand, 1965. He walked into the small police station at Ruatane with one of the Government Communications Security Bureau men in front of him and the other behind. Inspector Ogden led the way and said, Mr. Munro, sit here, thank you. Indicated the chair with his hand as he walked and did not look back. The old man sat and looked through the high window at the passing clouds. There were two iron bars across the window, painted white.
We have asked you to come here today, Mr. Munro, to clear up a few matters in relation to your service during the First World War.
The old man nodded and said,
Yes, sir.
He had removed his hat and was holding it in his hands.
As you probably know, New Zealand has, in accordance with the ANZUS Defence Treaty, committed combat troops to Vietnam.
No, sir. Vietnam?
Yes, Inspector Ogden said.
He sat at the desk facing the old man, He reached into his coat pocket, took out a packet of Camel cigarettes and a Zippo cigarette lighter.
Cigarette? He offered the packet. No, sir. Thank you.
Inspector Ogden extracted a cigarette from the packet and flicked open the lighter, lit the Camel and drew the smoke into his lungs, snapped the lighter shut.
We are, as a precaution and on advice, and as a matter of routine national security, examining and questioning all those who have a cross-reference to trials by court-martial and or with known links to the Communist Party, conscientious objection, pacifism and Islam. You, Mr. Munro, tick the box, as it were, on at least four counts, perhaps all.
Smoke was trickling from both nostrils. The inspector placed his palm on a pile of yellow files. The top file was open.
I do? Yes, you do, the inspector said quickly.
He had continued to stare at the file as he spoke. He looked up at the old man, his lips pressed together.
I realise, Mr. Munro, that this occurred some time ago. Nevertheless, let me assure you that what we have here is still of some concern. Considerable concern, actually.
The old man nodded.
Yes, sir. Very good, then.
The inspector moved his hand and looked down.
Your service record states that in October 1915, you aided a prisoner of war to escape from detention in a camp on the island of Lemnos, that you also deserted with the said prisoner. When you were later recaptured and imprisoned, you claimed to have become a conscientious objector and a pacifist. You would not take up arms against the enemy, in that case, the Germans. Is this true so far?
The old man looked at his hands, his fingers holding his grey felt hat, said,
Yes, sir.
He kept looking down, thumbs just starting to touch above the brim of the hat, his head beginning to shake gently from side to side. Inspector Ogden drew in his cigarette and looked over his shoulder at Sergeant McMillan, who was standing behind him with his hands loosely clasped, fingers intermeshed. Big hands and big fingers. There was black hair on the backs of his fingers and on the side of each hand, flat, broken knuckles. Sergeant McMillan raised his eyebrows and then pulled his lips in to form a thin line across his teeth, tilted his head slightly. His nose had been broken at least once. There was a scar across the bridge. Inspector Ogden turned back to the old man with a smile. His own father was about the same age. Said,
All right then,
and picked up the cigarette lighter. He turned the lighter over in his fingers and frowned as he examined the emblem.
Is there anything you would like to tell us, Mr. Munro?
The old man stared at the inspector, shook his head.
No, sir, there's nothing.
Inspector Ogden stared at him for a moment and then looked down and opened the yellow file again, turned over two sheets of paper.
Sentenced to...
The inspector paused as he read.
Death.
He looked up from his reading. A finger marked his place. The old man was looking above his head, out the small window with the two bars.
You were sentenced to death, Mr. Munro.
He tapped his finger on the page.
To be shot. Is that right?
The old man barely moved his head to nod, blinked, still staring out the window. The brim of the hat moved between his fingers. The inspector looked down and continued to read.
Desertion and aiding the enemy to escape. Pretty serious stuff. Treason. Traitorous conduct, it says. You were a traitor to your country, Mr. Munro. Is that right?
The old man made a noise in his throat, like a father would make to a child who asked him a question he couldn't answer. A wise God question.
Is that right, Munro?
The inspector smacked his hand down flat on the files.
Is it? What do you have to say for yourself?
The old man looked at him. They were both quiet for some time.
Nothing,
he said.
Nothing?
No.
They waited. Then the old man said,
I have been called that. Traitor, that name.
Moved his gaze away then to his left.
Really?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.